Hello, everybody. I think we're going to get started. The line seems to be pretty short over here, and we can catch up. If you haven't heard, if you arrived late, there's a raffle for a Samsung Galaxy Tab 3. Did I get the name of that right, Ben?
You did.
Yes. Okay, excellent. So to enter, fill it out, fill out an information form over here. It's got an Excel spreadsheet. And then there will be some sort of spreadsheet wizardry to select a random person from that list. Somebody better at Excel. So that's it. Please do that, and then we'll do that at the end, I think. Just some brief housekeeping before we begin. We've gone through the networking, do some introductions, talk about some upcoming events, and then we'll dig right in. How many of you, is this your first mobile portal meeting? You can raise your hand. Okay, awesome. Well, welcome. Just a little bit about us. We are Mobile Portland, where we talk about mobile, obviously, and we try to vary it. So, you know, once a quarter we'll have something that's technical, one that's business, marketing, one that's social, you know, like mobile and education, or the impact of augmented reality in our physical world, those sorts of things. We meet on the fourth Monday of every month, with the exception of December for holidays. There's an international organization called Mobile Mondays. We are not affiliated with them, but that is why we've got that's why we meet on Mondays. If you haven't, you should sign up for the mailing list, mobileportland.com. You can sign up for just an announcements list, so you'll get two emails a month, one announcing the event, and the other sort of reminding you about the event. So low volume email list. There's only been one time where there's been a third email, and I still apologize for that. That was a mistake on my part, typo, but I wanted to make sure everybody got to the right place. And then there's a Google group where there are job postings and discussion, and it also is pretty low volume, but if you're interested in that sort of stuff, that's where to go. And if you're looking for resources, if you're looking for freelancers or developers, that's the best place to go to ask those sorts of questions. You can follow us on Twitter, and then if you want to join Matt on IRC, he's got a private chat channel. Is anyone in there anymore? Should I take this off the slide?
I'm not in there anymore.
You're not in there anymore. I don't know. I kind of like leaving it on there, just to harass you about it. Yeah, so Matt is available for any sort of personal mobile questions you have in this IRC channel. He'll answer all of them for you. Okay, so next, job openings announcements. So if you have a job opening or an event that you want to announce, if you want to raise your hand, Matt will run around and just keep it really short so we can move on to the content as quickly as possible. Anyone, raise your hand.
Hey guys, I'm Will with Modus. I'm here with Nick. We're working with a local startup in the mobile space. We've got three telecommute after-hours opportunities right now. Back-end Java developer, Sencha Touch specialist, and then a Sencha Touch also specialist that doesn't have to do any coding. We just want to bounce ideas off of them. So come talk to Nick or I afterwards. We're happy to share the information.
I'm with Evo Solutions, and we are looking for test automation engineers using for Android, iOS apps mainly, but using Calabash and Cucumber. Anybody have any experience? Thanks.
Good evening. My name is Venki. I'm with Sigma Consultants. We are looking for a project manager with extensive experience in the healthcare industry. It's a long-term consulting. I'm sorry, it's not a mobile space. I'm sure the client will focus on mobile in the near future. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Sean Sullivan. I'm a developer at Guild Group. Guild is an e-commerce fashion retailer. We have openings on our mobile team. We have iPhone app, iPad app, mobile web, and Android. Right now, we're actually about 40% of our revenue is coming from our mobile apps. So we're making big investments there. Come talk to me if you're looking for work.
Hey, my name is Tristan Waddington, and this is my coworker Tad, and we work at Symbol Finance here in town, which is an online bank. We would love to get some more Android and iOS devs. We're a small team. If you want to come talk to us, come say hi. If you want an invite, let us know. We'd be happy to have you as a customer. We're just generally happy to talk to people doing cool stuff, so come say hi.
I'm with a mobile app startup called Auto App, and looking for a part-time job developer that knows Hibernate in Jersey. So if you're interested, please give me a call or stop by and talk to me. I'm just part-time, so you can probably work it in around your regular schedule.
All right, in addition, New Relic has started working on bringing in speakers from out of town, sort of in conjunction with a lot of the local user groups. And they've got an event coming up for a talk with Jessica McKellar. She's gonna be doing Future Talk, or that's the session, the series that they're doing. And I'm trying to remember what the, it's like an introduction to the internet structure and protocols through fun experiments from Python perspective. It looks really good, and I will send out the link to the Google group, so if you are interested in that, or if you want more information, I can provide you the link. It's actually a free event that New Relic's putting on, and they're bringing her in. I think she's based in New York, so they're trying to gather speakers from outside the area and fly them in for these sorts of events. Pretty exciting stuff that they're doing. The other thing I wanted to note, there are some open chairs if people want them. There's a few around if you want to grab a seat. And I think that's it for housekeeping. So I want to introduce Daniel, and actually don't have, it's Peter or Pete, I'm sorry, Paul. Ah, Peter, okay. So we got Paul instead of Peter, who is his brother. But we got these two folks from Intel, and they are going to talk to us about the really cool stuff that Intel's doing for Android tools and community. I just want to say that as, like, when we've been doing Android development, we have found that using the Intel-specific, like, SDKs and emulators have been easier from a development perspective because of the fact that they run faster on our machines than emulating ARM. So I'm really interested to see the other stuff that they have, because so far it's been a big boon to us having Intel doing Android stuff. So please join me in welcoming Daniel.
Something that I was going to cover it on the slides here.
Oh, sorry.
But it's great to mention it. I'm going to have to apologize. I am coming down with a cold, and so you will probably hear me coughing quite a bit during this, but we'll push on through this. Today, what we're going to talk about is how Intel is interacting with the Android community. And we do this on a number of different fronts. First of all, we have, of course, our mobile CPUs, and Intel is making a lot of news recently for the release of Bay Trail, which is our best mobile CPU, our current generation of mobile CPUs. But we also do an incredible amount of software enablement in the Android community, and that's one thing that I think that Intel is usually understated, and it's kind of overlooked the enabling work that we do. We do enabling work, of course, on Windows. On Android, we work with an incredible amount with the Linux community as well as with Apple. And the enablement groups that we have are dedicated to making sure that if it computes, it computes on Intel, and you're going to find a best-of-class experience. Also, if any of you have any questions, feel free to stop me at any point. So then we're going to talk about writing compiled applications and what it takes to write an Intel native binary on an Android platform. How many of you are developers, by the way? There's probably a good there's a lot of developers here. How many of you are not developers? What roles do you have? Are you project managers? Marketing? Just somebody over here. I want to hear what's in the room. Okay. Somewhat like me. I was a developer for 14 years, and now I'm doing developer relations. Anybody else?
QA.
QA? Okay, great.
Consultant, jack of all trades, interested in everything.
Okay, so even what I'm getting is that even those of you who aren't developers still have a heavy development focus. So that's great. We're going to be going through some porting tips here. And then also we're going to talk about what it means to build your Android application from multiple architectures and how that's accomplished. So the majority of devices out there are ARM devices. And of course we want you to know how you can deploy both Intel and ARM and any other type of architecture that you have currently. I actually met somebody at the Samsung Developer Conference who was writing the programs for a MIPS Android device. It was the first person I had met that was doing that. So that was kind of fun. And after that, we're going to talk about third-party support for Intel, and then Intel's Android tools. And then at the very end of my talk, the last tool that I'm going to mention is the Intel XDK, which is an HTML5 mobile software environment for creating mobile apps in HTML5. And for that, I'm going to ask Paul to come up and talk about that. All right. One event that happened recently is that Intel talked to their investment groups, and a lot of the high-level management got up on stage and made some admissions that I was actually very glad they made, because as a person at Intel that often interacts with the community, I'm often asked about, you know, when is Intel creating a great mobile CPU? Do you guys think that you missed the mobile boom? And a couple of weeks ago, our new CEO, Brian Krzanich, got up on stage and spoke frankly with investors, and he said that we at Intel are making a big switch, and we're moving over into gearing a large percentage of our processing line towards mobile. And not only mobile, but also Internet of Things. So what that means is, if any of you heard about 3 months ago, we introduced the Quark processor, which is a new line of Intel CPUs. The Quark processor is about 1/5 the size of an Atom processor and runs on 1/10 the wattage. And so it's specifically designed to be embeddable. It's designed to work in small devices, on wearable computing, on low power situations. We also recently introduced an LTE modem, which was said on stage that was the main reason why Intel processors are not more prevalent in the US. If you go to other parts of the world where LTE is not a major factor, you're going to find a lot more Intel phones present in those areas. I'll show you some of those here. So in 2012, we introduced our first mobile processor, which was named Netbit. I'll go through this fairly quickly because, actually, how many of you are really interested in the roadmap on CPUs, and how many of you do want to move on more quickly to software? Software? Okay, we'll move this quickly. So Medfield was introduced in 2012. It was basically Intel putting its toe in the water and saying, we're here, we're present. There were several good tablets and phones that were based on that, so we quickly came up with Clover Trail in the same year. And Lenovo and Asus and several manufacturers put out tablets based on that. In 2013, we introduced Clover Trail Plus, and this was the first time that there was an option for an LTE modem. And this processor significantly increased the compute power of the mobile processor and brought the wattage down. But about 8 weeks ago, Bay Trail was announced. And Bay Trail is going to be a major market mover as manufacturers begin creating platforms with it. Bay Trail is the first of our CPUs that integrates Intel HD graphics. So you don't need a separate graphics controller in the mobile device, which is big. It's that OEMs are going to be able to integrate it into their systems easier because they don't have to worry about the graphics controller. It's also twice as fast as the Clover Trail Plus CPU, and it has three times the graphics performance. It's also based on 22 nanometer technology. Clover Trail Plus was as well, but 22 nanometer technology is technology right now that no other company is able to match. What that means is that the transistors within the CPU are at that particular scale. And as we go into 2014, we are going to be putting out 14 nanometer CPUs, which are again going to help us drop the voltage, increase the compute power. In 2014, we're also going to be introducing several security-based solutions that are in hardware. A lot of them are from McAfee, so technologies such as DeepSafe and DeepTrust that allow the operating system to, on a hardware level, provide security policies that can be enforced. And also in 2014, these CPUs will be capable of doing 4K graphics. So here are some of the CPUs that we introduced in 2000, phones that were based on CPUs that we created in 2012. I won't spend very much time here other than maybe even to mention the Holmlund. I used to live in France, and so I got to see this phone, and it's a nice phone. My favorite phone in the lot here is actually the Lenovo K900 up on the top right. It's got a beautiful screen. It's 1080. Across and 1920 down. And for me, I was getting about a day and a half to 2 days worth of battery life on it. And it's a large phone, it's 5.5 inches, but it's a beautiful phone. It runs very quickly. And then we also introduced some tablets. Most recently was the Dell Venue 7 and 8. This was announced 3-4 weeks ago. It's a Windows 8.1 tablet. There's also the Samsung Galaxy Tab 3, which is what we're auctioning off today. And that's Samsung's top of the line. So in the future, with Bay Trail, Bay Trail was based on an entirely new microarchitecture called Silvermont. That's what's powering Bay Trail. That's what's going to power the next CPU iteration we put out. And that's also what's powering Merrifield, which is a phone CPU. It's an SoC system. So these are the current CPUs that Intel is putting out into the market and what the current technologies are based upon. So, for the developers out there, how to target multiple apps using NDK. How many of you are programming Android applications using the NDK? What's your app do?
I've written a video game engine that compiles using the NDK. So it's compiling using the NDK to Android platforms. It also compiles natively to iOS and PC platforms.
Very cool. Anybody else? Okay.
What does NDK stand for?
NDK is the native development kit. It is available at Android developer.android.com. And it's basically, if you don't want to write to a Java virtual machine, you can use the NDK in order to access data shared libraries. So it's the three major cases that I have seen so far, and that's why I always ask about it, because we want to understand who's using native technologies and why they're using it. The three major cases that I usually see for it are gaming, and then video and sound editing, and then also perhaps if you have legacy code. So I ran into a guy from Nuance who was working on the swipe keyboard. And that's well known for being written in C and portable to many different platforms. And so they were using the NDK to bring that over to Android. So, before we talk about the NDK, let's talk about Dalvik. Do you all know what Dalvik is? Yes? Okay, for those of you who don't, Dalvik is a Java virtual machine that's present on every Android device. When you write your application in Java and you compile it, you're compiling it down to Dex code, and that Dex code runs on Dalvik. So Dalvik has many of the drawbacks that are traditional to a virtual machine. That is, basically, there's a layer of software in between you and the actual hardware. But having said that, Dalvik apps, if you have a Dalvik app and you're trying to target an Intel-based device like the Galaxy Tab 3, there's no work, almost no work that you need to do. Intel actually has an entire team that works with Google optimizing the Dalvik virtual machine. And so that team makes sure that Dalvik runs excellently on Intel-based devices. Now, if you're compiling to an NDK or a native app, then you're obviously either compiling to an ARM binary, or to an Intel binary, or a MIPS binary, if you're that guy from the Samsung Dev Conference. And in those cases, you're going to need something in order to make your ARM binary run on an Intel device. And luckily, Intel actually does provide that. And we contract with all of the OEMs in order to make sure that it's installed on all Intel-based Android tablets. So what I'm referring to is actually the NDK app bridging technology. This is software that Forwall was called libHoudini. And what this is it is a software layer of redirection that will take an ARM binary and compile it out to an x86 binary on the fly. So if you do have an ARM binary and you want to deploy it to an Intel-based tablet, that's not a problem. It runs through libHoudini, which translates it on the fly, and it runs. Is there any questions about that? I think that now it's on all the devices that are sold. I wasn't aware that the other devices didn't have it. That is true. That's one major point. If you install the Intel emulator, libHoudini is, or the NDK bridging technology, is not installed on the emulator. So if you have ARM-specific code, you have to test it in the ARM-specific emulator. So these are the six major ways that Intel, there are more ways than just this, but these are the ways that Intel interacts with the Android community. The first one here is that we are a key contributor to the Android open source project and a key contributor to the Linux kernel. In fact, Intel is the number one contributor to the Linux kernel. We passed up Red Hat about a year and a half ago in terms of lines and patches committed. And that's something that we're very proud of. We have an entire division at Intel. It's dedicated to open source technology. It's called the Open Source Technology Center. And it's quite a large division, actually. So we do a lot of optimization to make sure that Linux, Android, and all Linux-based devices are open source-based devices run best on Intel. The second thing we do is we have teams that are working with the OEMs to optimize drivers and firmware. So that's just something we do with the OEMs to make sure that the devices run well. One other thing I should back up and say to this too is that Intel has traditionally been very Windows focused. Well, as of a couple of months ago, we got the verdict handed down from on high that we're supposed to support Android equally with Windows. So we are now supporting both operating systems in terms of resources, in terms of personnel working on them. We're switching over and heavily supporting Android. We have a team that's dedicated to tuning Dalvik. I already mentioned that, so I won't talk about that too much more. And then porting and optimizing browsers and applications, web applications. In
Intel is actually the number three contributor to the WebKit project. Google is obviously the number one contributor, Apple's the number two contributor. Until about a year ago, independent developers were the number three contributor. And that's actually something that the WebKit project should be really proud of, having so many independent developers contributing to the project. Intel has quite a number of people now that are directly contributing to this project. And we have a team that's working on creating a 64-bit version of Android. So when processors that have come out and we're going to see it, there will be a 64-bit edition available. All right, if you want to configure your project to compile using the NDK or an Intel-based platform, it's fairly easy to do. All you really need to do is change an environmental variable, depending on the complexity of your environment. But for a basic build environment, this environmental variable, app_API, is going to control which platforms your compiler toolchain is targeting. So the NDK by default comes with GCC, and GCC will compile for ARMv7, ARMv5, x86, and Linux. And so if you want to configure, maybe you don't want to configure all of them, you can also say just directly ABI, app_ABI is equal to x86, or you can say is equal to ARMv7 space x86, however you want to configure it. And when you have that option configured, your compiler toolchain is going to start creating what's called fat binaries. A fat binary is a binary that has compiled code for each of the architectures in a single installer package. So it looks kind of like this. You have a lib directory inside your APK file, and then you have an architecture or several architecture directories under it. So when you compile for the ARM API, you're going to end up with an SO file, a shared object file that's in that directory. The same goes for all the different architectures that you're covering. Are there any questions about that?
On the store, is it going to, if you go the other route and compile an APK per platform, is that going to be handled magically by the store since the presumably it knows what your architecture is and it should show you only your compatible?
Right. I think the answer is it's semi-magic. You have to, in your Android manifest, specify to the store how you're setting it up. But as of about April, I think it's around April 2011, that functionality was added. So originally, fat binaries were used quite heavily by developers because you could only upload one install package. You create your application on the store, and you give a title and all the information you need to fill in. But then you could only upload one installer package. As of about 2011, April-ish, you can upload multiple install packages. And so, one thing that we recommend actually as a best practice, this is taken directly off the Google developer documentation for choosing an Android version code. And they mention in the documentation the way the store works is that the higher your version code number is, the version code that's the highest will be tested first against an incoming install request. So at Intel, when Intel engineer, I'm not sure who it was, came up with these numbers here. The 2 and 6 are the only numbers that Intel added to this. The rest are directly taken off the Android developer documentation. These version numbers can be anything you want, but we're recommending you test the Intel version first, and that's precisely because we have the smallest market share. And so, for instance, if an Intel device is the one requesting an application, the store is going to say, okay, I have this particular application with this highest version code. And if that's your x86 version, it's going to try your x86 version against the device that's there. If that, and if it is x86, it will install it. And if it's not, it's going to try the next highest number. And in that particular case, the next highest number might be an ARM binary. The majority of people will receive an ARM binary. But architecture isn't the only thing that you have to switch based on. You can switch based on the API level, or the screen size, or any criteria you wish to switch on. Maybe you have a
tablet version and the phone version. Those sorts of things. For game developers that are out there, I hope your game library supports x86. These are game libraries that do support x86. So the first one we usually mention up here is Havoc. Havoc is a AAA game library that was pretty much exclusively built to service that market, so multi-million dollar games. Intel purchased them. How long ago? So 2 years ago? Okay. So once Intel purchased them, we actually open sourced the code, and it's available now on GitHub. You can download the code for free, start playing around with it. Thank you. Water would be better than that. The thing that we are doing now with that code is we're integrating more features for indie developers. So smaller development shops. The tools are fairly focused on high-end shops. We're trying to bring them down so more people can adopt them. I'll let you look at the rest here. Some of the notable ones, Unreal Engine, Marmalade, are available. The notable engines that do not support x86 are Corona and Unity. Somebody always asks, when will they be available? I say, please go ask them that question. Any of the SIMD instructions or NEON instructions?
I do use the MMX because the NEON.
Okay. So for those of you who don't know NEON or MMX, NEON is a set of accelerated instructions for doing video and audio processing on ARM-based devices. The equivalent instruction sets on Intel are called MMX, SSC, SSC2, SSC3. And these all have larger sizes, so if you have larger vector-based numbers, it does large vector-based calculations. And the unfortunate thing about these is that these are architecture-specific, so if you use them, which you should if you're creating a video or a library, then your code's not portable. So what Intel engineers started this project, Neon versus SSC.h, that actually goes through and it macro redefines all 1700 Neon instructions. And you can drop this 1H file on your project, and it's going to go through and macro redefine your Neon instructions so that they're Intel equivalents. What this means is that there should be a minimal amount of porting that's necessary by you. I won't say there's no porting, but because there is some porting, we also provide a test harness that you can use to make sure that if you drop this into your project, that all the macros that it's redefining, all the intrinsics, are properly redefined. So there's both a quick way of reporting it and its best harness you can test it against. All right. The Intel emulator was mentioned earlier. I do have a demo of that if you want to see it. But for now, let me just say that on this particular machine, it benchmarked at around 7 times faster than the ARM emulator. And the reason why that is because since it's x86 code that's running, we can apply a virtualization driver and run that directly on the CPU, whereas the ARM emulator needs to be ran in software. So if you want to, and even if you're targeting ARM devices, I highly recommend you use the Intel emulator because it's going to bring that develop, test, debug cycle way down for the developer. If you want to install it, it's right over here. You can see the x86 pad image is there. The ARM image is the one directly above it. But then you go down to the extras category down here. And you go to the very bottom, and it'll say Intel Hardware Accelerated Execution Manager. That's your virtualization driver that's going to speed up your Android emulator. So this is an entirely informal benchmark
that I ran on my work laptop right here. But this was the Intel emulator running on my work laptop, as benchmarked by N22. And then this is the ARM emulator, as benchmarked by N22. As you can see, that's a significant difference. It actually makes it usable, which the ARM emulator, at least I have nothing but frustrations with it. This is the Intel emulator running on my laptop again, versus my 2013 Nexus 7. So you can see it's very comparable in terms of being a real device, and you can do real testing using it. The next tool that I want to mention that Intel makes available is called Beacon Mountain. And Beacon Mountain is actually now at version 0.07. It's iterating very quickly right now. We're working towards a 1.0 towards the end of this year, next year. But Beacon Mountain is a installer that will, on a new system, it will go through and download all the tools that you need for Android development. So it's going to go through and download the Google Android SDK, the NDK, the Eclipse development environment, of course, the Android Design Studio, when it's packaged. It's actually not being patched at the moment because it's kind of buggy at the moment. So we're still waiting for some of those bugs to be shaken out before it's included in the package. And then also Cygwin is there for compatibility with Windows operating systems. On the Intel tools side, you get the Hardware Acceleration Execution Manager, Graphics Performance Analyzer, the Integrated Performance Primitives, and Thread Building Blocks, and a Software Manager. So I'm going to go through all those tools really quickly. The Software Manager is a manager that sits in the background, and if any of these have updates, it'll go through and automatically update it for you. I'll show you a demo of Graphics Performance Analyzer. But the two common use cases for this is if you just want to set up a development environment really quickly, or if you have a product team and you want to make sure that they're rolling out identical development tools. There's a lot of different ways that you can set up these development tools, and a lot of developers have their own particular ways, perhaps, of setting them up. This will do a rollout that will cause your entire team to have identical tools. The next tool that I wanted to show you was the Intel Compiler for Android. It was actually just revved last week to version 14. And it is available at software.intel.com at c-compiler-android. If you are targeting x86 systems, I highly recommend you go check this out because it on integer-based tests, at least, will perform about 30% faster than the equivalent GCC chain. Do you use that for your game?
I do not. I haven't heard of this Intel C++ framework yet, but I'm going to check it out.
And then if you want to look at the benchmarks, they have all sorts of information online on other forms. I will give one caveat now. As of last week, it's no longer free. It's $80 because they rolled out the version 14.
Okay.
Threading Building Blocks is a library which abstracts away the threading process and gives you a different paradigm, I suppose. You create a task, and then you give it a reduction function. So here is actually the code for computing pi. This library, what it does is, given a task and a data set to do it over, will find the most efficient way to utilize whatever system that it's on. So if you have a two-core or a quad-core system, or however your system's laid out, it's highly optimized to make sure that your task is going to run best on that particular system. It doesn't work on ARM. And I probably,
the TDD is not required.
That's right. It is open source.
It's open source.
It is open source. Graphics Performance Library here. Give me just one moment to plug in.
lets you perform all sorts of analysis directly on your Intel-based laptop or tablet. In this particular case, I'm going to go down and I'm going to do a system view, which is going to do a profiling of the entire system, and you get real-time statistics on what's going on in your system. You can also profile an application or a particular process, and in that particular case, you're going to get slightly different statistics that you can read out over here. If it's an OpenGL application, you will actually get all your OpenGL primitives. This one on the side, you can read them in real time. So for instance, what you might do with this tool is, let's say that some of your users say that your frame rate is dropping in a particular scene on your game. You can stick the CPU load next to the GPU, next to the frame rate, and go through a sequence in your game and record that sequence, and then send it to several people on your team for analysis. So this will let you, in case you can't see over here, it will let you track different CPUs, each of the cores independently. It'll also let you track disk writes, network writes, various GPU statistics, memory available, and it also lets you track the current battery level. So it's often interesting to see, you know, if your application is high on GPU and high on CPU, or maybe it's using the network a lot, what exactly is that doing on its current draw on the battery? So you can test those sorts of things as well. This is a free tool that's available at software.intel.com/GPA.
Can you hook it up to the emulator?
You can, yeah. Although, yeah, you can. You can get a lot of useful information that way. At this point, I'm going to ask Paul to come up if I've left you any time. How much time do we have?
Oh, probably 15 minutes.
Okay.
Yes, I'm on. Okay, so I'll go quickly. You're not going to be able to get a full view of the Intel XDK, but I will try to give you a taste, and I believe that
probably have.
Oh, it does, yeah. I won't look in that direction. we have the opportunity to do a presentation that's a deeper dive into the XDK if people are interested in that, probably sometime next quarter. Or and actually, the product that you're seeing here is free, by the way. So if anybody's wondering how much this costs, it costs $0. But you can, it was just introduced in September, this particular variant that we're looking at. And let's see, how do I do that? I mean, I should just shove this right up into my lip here so that it's hanging off any. There's actually a lot of changes that are taking place. There's going to be a new release in December. There'll be another one in probably about the February time frame, and we'll see more after that. So this is pretty ugly, what you're looking at right there. Let's look at something more interesting. And let me take a look at. So, what this thing is it's a. What? Where is it? Sorry. That's this one right here. So, what this thing is a tool for creating HTML5 hybrid apps. So, in fact, there's no NDK involved, there's no Intel specific binaries involved. This thing strictly creates it using HTML5 bound up PhoneGap apps or Cordova apps, or they have other names, but it's a hybrid app. So is everybody familiar with how a PhoneGap app is constructed? I see a lot of heads shaking yes. Okay. So this thing has it's a mechanism for helping you create these. Now you can still do them on your own. It doesn't encapsulate your project into some angled thing that you can't use. You can use other tools with this. If you take a look here, there's an editor built in. Brackets editor is actually what you see here. I'm not going to show you how the brackets editor works, but if you have a favorite editor, which most people do, you don't have to use this editor. It's a quick and dirty editor that you can use when you're in the tool doing some testing and so forth, but your files are on your disk, organized the way you want to organize them, and you just use your editor to get at them that way, and you can use it side by side with the tool. So it's not an attempt to say, this is where you live, this is how you work. No, it's an attempt at trying to supplement and make certain parts of the task easier. And you'll see the tabs across the top. We've got develop, emulate, test, build. Emulate, I'll show you quickly, is a kind of a simulator. Develop has two halves to it, depending on how you build your application. Test is a way to actually test on device, which I'll try to do a quick demo of here. And then build is a mechanism for doing a build in the cloud. One of the big problems with creating PhoneGap or Cordova apps is you need to have the whole development system in order to turn the crank and make that binary. So if you're going to make an iOS binary from PhoneGap, you got to have a Mac with Xcode, and you got to, and then bring the PhoneGap or Cordova stuff into that, and then do your build. If you're going to do that for Android, you got to have the Android SDK and the PhoneGap bits and put it in there. If you are going to do a Windows 8 PhoneGap app, which you can do for the modern or for Windows 8 phone. Likewise, you're going to have Visual Studio 2012 on there, or 13 now, or whatever it is, and on a Windows machine. So it starts getting kind of hairy when you start talking more than. So I'll just speak loudly, and that way everyone can hear me, whether or not this microphone works. Well, are you recording through the microphone?
We're not through the microphone, but the camera picks it up better with the mic.
Okay.
But it's just...
Okay.
It's been every month since we moved here, we've been trying to figure out, like, why it cuts out.
Okay, I'm more worried about this. Ignore it. So the build system, since it's in the cloud, means I don't have to have all that stuff on my system. I don't have to learn how to actually assemble a PhoneGap app. I just have to learn how to use the API. So that's the point behind the build system. You'll find the same thing. Adobe has PhoneGap Build, and there are several other tool vendors that have things like this that they do build. Usually, most of the other tool vendors limit you to iOS and Android. PhoneGap has a wider offering, and so does this tool. So we're not trying to compete with Adobe. They actually have a whole lot of wonderful tools. We're just trying to provide a useful environment in which in order to build these apps. You might be wondering, why does Intel care about HTML5 apps? Well, as you know, we're not real big in the mobile market yet. And so the only way you're probably going to create anything that's useful on an Intel platform is you're going to have to do it this way, or using this kind of a tool, a cross-platform development tool. As this tool matures, we'll be adding other bits and pieces that can also target Intel products, but as a whole, the tool can be used for ARM or x86. It does not discriminate. In fact, there's nothing in this tool that's specifically targeted at x86. So, by the way, the tool downloads and installs on Windows, Linux, and OS X equally.
It's running a
WebKit. So it looks and operates exactly the same as what you see here on each of those platforms. No, that's okay. So this little particular app that's in here right now, unfortunately the screen is not as wide as it would be nice to have it, so it's a little scrunched up. But there's a layout tool in here that's called, just referred to as App Designer. You can drag and drop bits and pieces up on here. And in particular, this thing is designed, you see that little triangle up at the top there? It's designed to help you create responsive web design apps. So you see my buttons are going down, you see some colors are changing as a result of passing over that particular wrap point. If I bring this back up, let me see if I can find the... Yeah, oops, I have it there. So I just created a little style here that says change that to red when we go below that wrap point, and you'll see the green changes to red. And it's also set up so that it's going to align left. It's actually this one, I think. I change that to left and then that other way. And now the buttons go to the bottom. So, and this is actually an actively evolving tool right here. There's a tremendous amount of improvements that will be taking place in this December release, and I would expect more after that. In this particular little sample is using, so the tool itself provides the grid system, but it's built on top of a standard UI framework. This particular one is using Bootstrap. When you create one of these UI apps, you have four choices right now. There may be others that will be added. They are Topcoat, Bootstrap, jQuery Mobile, and what's called App Framework. We changed the name of it. I was going to say jQuery Mobile, but it's App Framework. App Framework is actually when you first see it, it kind of looks like jQuery Mobile, but it's not. But it's been optimized for mobile devices, and so you'll see that it actually has a lot more fluid actions on it. But you can pick any one of them that you want. It's using the widgets and the styling in those frameworks. So for example, Bootstrap has its own grid system. The Bootstrap grid system is not being used here, just the widgets and styling are being used here. And there's a comp grid system that's being applied. You can go in and you see this is the code that it actually generates. You see there's lots of little classes aligned there and so forth. You can throw in your own CSS styling on top of it to override what's being done. And then, of course, you can add to this, but and it will respect your comments and so forth and everything. So it attempts to be, and it's a round trip kind of a layout editor. So the idea here is not that this display once, or this layout once, and I'm stuck with what I got. I can go back and change it. I can put code in here, and I can go back and change it. So there's also a little tag here called emulate, and you said there's that same little app that was in there. If I flip it, you see it's changed because the width changed accordingly, so the layout of the buttons and so forth changed. Now this particular app doesn't do anything. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch to a different one. That will help show off some of the stuff. So this says emulator. I prefer to call it a simulator. It's actually a Cordova simulator. Because this tool is written in Node WebKit, you've got a Chromium browser built into this thing. So the rendering engine that's being used to execute this code is Chrome. So it's not exactly the same as what's going to end up in your web view on a device. So it's a place to debug and so forth, as if you were using a desktop browser, but it's not going to give you identical results to what you see on the device, which there's a way to show that as well here. But it is a very, very useful branch. It does include, for example, because it's Chrome, it's got full Chrome DevTools in it. So let me like that, and at some point they're going to fix the bug where you have to have it in two separate windows. But for example, if I hover over, you see as I move across these devices, they're highlighting just as if I was in, you know, Chrome DevTools on, you know, in a regular browser. And I've got some, if I run this thing, you'll see at the bottom there, I've just got some console log messages in here as I click these buttons. And one thing I've got going on that's a little different than running in a Chrome browser, on the left-hand side, I'm dragging this. I've got my finger down on this thing, and I'm dragging around on it as though I had the phone, and I'm tilting it around like that. So I'm getting feedback as if I had a real accelerometer, so it's faking it, you know. But it allows your logic to run and so forth. Same thing here, if I click this one, it's got the compass, and you see up in the little thing rotating around giving the numbers, and my numbers are tracking right there what the compass is. So that's the significant difference then between trying to debug in a Chrome browser versus debugging in this thing, because this thing's got a bunch of Cordova APIs plugged into the bottom of it that you can execute. They're not just going to give you, you know, doesn't exist kinds of errors. Other than that, it's a Chrome browser. So what I can do, so that's what, and you've got a couple other devices here that I can, let's say that I want to look at and see what it looks like, say, in an iPhone 5. So it gives you a way to render and view in these other devices. Again, it's not a perfect simulation, it's close, but it does give you a sense of what it's going to look like on different devices here. So then what we can do, and likewise, if I had a geo thing on here, we could move the map around and it would allow us to simulate moving around, say, the city of Portland or something like that. Now what I can do is I can test this on a real device. I thought I brought up my tablet. Yes. and I see it finally sending. It's finally giving me the system update for 4.4. It showed up tonight, after weeks. So I didn't do that. So what you see is this QR code here. That particular app that we just saw has great. So goggles wanted to update. Sorry. Okay, so I'm going to snap that.
Where do you get those apps?
The apps?
Yeah, the previewer.
The previewer, yeah, so the thing that's happening is I'm installing this into a previewer. So I'm just grabbing the HTML5 bits
and they're getting dumped
in top of this container. So now you can see that app. And it's just a quick test of the app. And it's hard to see, but there, if you look real closely, very closely, you'll see some numbers moving there, just like they were moving before. And you know, but I didn't have to do a full build and send it into a store or sideload it or anything like that. I just dumped it onto here. There's a special app on here that currently is available for Windows 8 devices, Android devices, and iOS devices. So it makes it very easy to go through this. So you don't even have to go get a developer ID in order to do your testing here. Ultimately, you will have to get a developer ID if you want to submit one of these apps to a store. But for this sort of thing, you don't. The other thing that I can do here, which I can see, unless people want me to keep talking. Do you want me to keep talking or shut up? Okay. So this one should be set up. I hope I remember it's set up that way. So that I can also do a bit with Winery. Is anyone familiar with Winery? It's a remote Web Inspector Remote is what it's called. And so it almost is like using Chrome DevTools. And let me see if I can get that to work. I've got this running here. Sometimes this doesn't work in a crowd like this because it's called a demo die. Okay. So I've got it recognized my device here. I click go, say elements. And then, as I'm going over this stuff, you see on the device, just like before, where I assume you can see the blue screen, you know, is it, so I could go over here, I could change colors and that kind of thing.
And remember,
I had, so watch down here, I had some console log messages in there from when I clicked, touched these buttons to say that I've touched the button and so forth. And so those are coming through. So I'm actually running the code on this thing, but I'm seeing it over here, or you're seeing it up there. I'm seeing it over here. And so the only thing you can't do with Winery is you can't do JavaScript debugging. So Winery's great for just kind of getting, and by the way, this is exactly how this app would look like when I do a build on this. So this is a real representation. This is using the rendering engine that's in the device that your PhoneGap app's going to use. It's using the same APIs that are in the device. It's exactly how it's going to run on the device. except I got that little thing plugged in there. But I can't do JavaScript debugging this way because Winery doesn't support that. We are working on a variant of the preview which will support JavaScript debugging, and that is hopefully coming out real soon, but it's going to come out as a as kind of a preview first. But you know, over the course of the next 6 months or so, you'll see that mature. And so that will actually support full Chrome DevTool remote with JavaScript debugging, the whole wad. Right now, it supports it only over USB. This is supporting it this is actually running over the internet. I'm not doing this Wi-Fi direct. I'm doing this into the cloud and back. But there is a mode here where we can do it direct as well. And that other one will eventually support over Wi-Fi as well, so you won't have to plug it into a device. So after you're done, you've got everything working, and you've got this beautiful program like this, which is not very beautiful, then you're going to go and do a build. And these are the platforms you can build for. I mentioned it. There's Android, there's iOS, there's an iOS ad hoc, which makes it easier. By the way, you need to become an iOS, even if you're not going to have an Apple machine. You need to still become a developer. So you got to pay your $99, your dues, $99 dues to Apple. Likewise, you got to pay your $25 to Android, your one time. You got to get an MSDN or a Windows Mobile developer ID. So you have to get all that stuff to actually submit an app to the store. So the tool can't take that away, or we can't do that for you. And we can't actually submit to the store for you. Only build the pieces that are necessary to get you to the store, so we can give you the whole package that you need and you can get it up there. And so that's what this business will do, and it'll ask you a few questions about, you know, your app, pieces and parts that it uses and so forth for the permissions, and then it'll send the whole thing up, do the build, and there's a variety of ways you can have it delivered to your straight to your desk if you like, or straight to your neighbor's desk if you like that. Happy to answer questions.
It's probably more of a generic phone gap question.
Sure.
But is there a way you can specify what browser engine that might be installed on the device other than the one that installed with the operating system? For example, say you would like to target a browser that's supporting WebGL. Most devices that the phone browser's not, but Firefox or Chrome would be able to do it. Is there a way of telling it to use an alternate rendering engine with more features?
So the way that PhoneGap works is it can only work with what's called the native or inbuilt WebView, which means it can only use the WebView that's built in. Now, you've probably heard that with Android 4.4, Google's changing that to a certain degree because they're actually using Chrome as that built-in WebView with 4.4 and above. And this the bit that I talked about, it's a project called Crosswalk that Intel is sponsoring, is the thing that will support the more advanced remote debugging that I was talking about. That will also be usable as an alternative web view for Android 4.x devices. It won't fix the Android 2.x problem, but it will allow you to get a better better ring. And actually, you'll deliver the web view with the package, so it's going to be a bigger package. It's going to be like a 50 meg package or so, as opposed to, you know, a 5-10 meg package. So there is a draw. There is a drawback. And iOS won't let you deliver an alternate web view. It's just you're stuck with what they have, although theirs works good. The one on Windows 8 also won't let you, but it's actually a very, very good web view. So Android's really the biggest problem child with regard to that, and there are some fixes that are coming.
Crosswalk does support WebGL too.
Yeah. It's got very good performance characteristics.
So just want to take questions here. But before we do, I wanted to thank Paul and Daniel, and please give them a round of applause. We've got microphones, so either questions for Paul or Daniel, assuming his voice holds. And Matt will run around with the microphone, and I will hand off my microphone to Daniel. And so raise your hand if you've got a question. Oh, and it's really awesome if we get questions going back and forth, so Matt has to run more.
Two different aspects, can you guess? First of all, this development in Intel, is it happening in California or in Oregon?
The development is usually a worldwide effort. People are in different locations.
I imagine you have the number one contribution to the kernel, so would it be...
So OTC is definitely a worldwide organization, but there is a large number both in California and Oregon. It's one of the larger divisions of Intel, so it's worldwide.
There's also a fairly significant group in China, too,
yeah,
working on that.
A separate question here, the latest demo. Is the target the pure HTML5?
Yes. The target is pure HTML5. The code is HTML5. It does not get compiled or changed in any way. If you open up the APK, you'll see your code right there in it.
There's only the lowest version of Android or lowest version of iOS. It just generates HTML.
Yeah, it's standards compliant HTML5. And Intel actually works a lot with standards committees too. So we're very active in that area. And we're very much behind standards compliant.
Yeah, I think one maybe. Confusion is we're not, other than the exception I talked about where you could use crosswalk, which is a future feature, you use the local web rendering engine that's in the device. So you still kind of have to think about targeting, it's kind of like targeting different browsers, you're targeting different built-in web views, but they're largely much more similar than your browser issues have been in.
My question is about Android 4.4. Is that currently shipping for Intel-based devices?
I don't think it's
certainly not
currently shipping, but I'm pretty.
Yeah, I have noticed that in the XP manager, that if you go over to your API level 19.4, now you look for the Intel image, it's not there yet. I'm waiting for it to show up. I know there's a group that does that. So, one thing that I will mention, though, about KitKat is that it comes with a new runtime called ART. And ART is, it was worked on both by Google and Intel, and I'm assuming other engineers as well. But Intel is very heavily involved in optimizing ART. For those of you who don't know what ART is it is a replacement for Dalvik. And so instead of running your Java code on a Java virtual machine and compiling it down into its native components in the runtime, ART is a system that will, at install time, compile to a native binary. And so the result of that is that your startup times specifically are much quicker for your Android applications, but overall your Android performance is just better. So that's available in KitKat if you go into developer options and enable ART.
Okay. Thank you.
More questions?
Hey, do you plan to support Firefox OS in the XDK?
We don't have hard plans, but actually that's one that I keep pushing for, as well as you may have noticed there's Chrome OS on there, but we don't have, like, in the emulator currently, we only support Cordova API and then some extension APIs we call Intel XDK. So you've probably heard of Tizen. That's one that we will be supporting, is the Intel thing there. But yeah, I'd like to see us supporting Firefox OS, but there's no promise at this point. But it's a significant platform that I hope we will be supporting.
Before the next question, if you are interested in participating in the raffle, and you have not yet entered, you should take this opportunity while we're still doing questions to come over here and put in your information into the spreadsheet. This is for the Galaxy...
Tab 3.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
10-inch tab.
Galaxy something, all the Samsung products say Galaxy. Okay.
I was wondering how this system supported third-party plugins.
Today, we're not able to support them. We're in the process of, so our build system today is Cordova 2.9 compatible, but it's not a 100% Cordova container. And when we get to first quarter, we're now working on converting that over, so we will be 100% Cordova compatible. So it'll be a Cordova container complete. And then it'll be supporting 3.x at that point as well. So by definition, it'll be supporting plugins. That first release may or may not support your third-party plugin, but it definitely will at some point, because that's a huge feature that needs to be there. So
definitely plan to
support it. Exactly how you go about that is not clear yet, but when we get there.
The Intel SDK right now is still officially in preview. Is that correct?
No, it's officially released. There's if you look on the... Like about 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
if you go online looking for this thing, you can go to software.intel.com/html5, or you just Google and you should find it. There's two Intel SDKs. There's Intel SDK and there's Intel SDK new. And what I'm showing you is new, slanted new. But the new moniker will go away in about a month or so when the old one just completely goes away. And you may recognize the old one as the AppMovi XDK, and that's in fact what it is. And we purchased them back in February. We didn't actually purchase AppMovi. We purchased that part of the company that is the tool. So there's an AppMovi company that still exists, and they still provide services. In fact, if you go to the services tab, you'll see some of theirs listed. Screen's going weird over here. Sorry. So you'll find. Okay. So they're not showing us. They're responsible for that part actually. So it's supposed to do it. It's a web service thing. So that one will go away, and then this one. So this is a complete rewrite from ground up, actually.
Question: How well does this play with Google's Angular libraries?
I've written an Angular app using this.
Yeah, it can be done. In fact, you should be able to take any JavaScript library and use it here as long as it's an appropriate library to use in the context of a mobile app. There are some that are and some that aren't, but we're not dictating what libraries you use. The only place where you'd see that happen would be, in that layout tool at the beginning here, which won't show up now because I didn't do this happily, but we throw some libraries in there, but you still can use other libraries in conjunction with that. So.
Question.
On the tool side, are you doing anything with Xamarin compilation on Android there?
Not that I've heard of. That's about all I know.
So as a very simple Android developer using the standard SDK and Dalvik and all of that, is there anything I have to do to worry about with Intel processors on mobile devices? Anything I should be thinking about if I'm just using the standard SDK?
So what I would say to that is that as far as portability, no, the Intel Dalvik teams optimize that on your behalf. But we do have a whole series of tools that we hope you take advantage of, or not, it's your choice, most of them are free. So that's where you could
And there was a question earlier about the fat versus multiple thins, and I wanted to mention that, your answer regarding the store takes care of it automatically, but if you're distributing those multiple thins on some of the Chinese stores, there are some problems with some of those stores because they don't know how to distinguish them properly, they're not doing the right thing. So we actually have a group in China that's working with those stores to make sure that they do the right thing, but you can experience some problems with native code in an Android binary that gets downloaded incorrectly on the wrong device, and that's actually a store problem, not your developer problem, but it's obviously a customer problem when it happens. So there, Intel's working with those stores to get that problem fixed.
Hi, I'd like to use the x86 emulator images, but my app depends on Google Play services. Are there any plans to ship an emulator image with the Google APIs?
I don't have any knowledge of that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Probably do two more questions, and we'll wrap it up.
I was just wondering if you could go back to the data analyzer. Was that an Intel product, or is it a...
You mean the profiler?
The profiler, the
graphics performance analyzer.
Okay.
And I'm sorry, it's on my computer, which is listed over here. But that is an Intel product. It's free. Okay. Go to software.intel.com/GPA and get it set. All right. Sounds like it's raffle time.
Yeah, so you've got a way to randomize it?
I've got this website called random.org.
Nice. Somebody in this room built it.
Make sure you guys all grab t-shirts.
Yes, there are free t-shirts.
I've got sizes too, the lemon hair. So, sizes for everybody. They shrink if you wash them in hot water, so it's not quite your size, but the next bigger one. Wash it dry, it'll fit. The ladies are right here.
Thank you.